Welcome to this webinar, What's New in Monex Suite 2020. The 2020 version has not been released yet. It is planned for October, but it is our pleasure to present you in advance its great new features. This presentation will be done by Pauline Trénard, our application manager. If you want to ask questions during the presentation, please type them in the Q&A tab and we will answer them at the end. This webinar is being recorded, and I'll now give the mic over to Pauline.
Thank you, Géraldine, and again, welcome everyone in this webinar. So first, I will give an overview of the main features in Monolix 2020, and then I will show some of these features in a live demo. So this new Monolix suite includes many big or small features, and here is a non-exhaustive list with the main ones. The biggest new feature is the new application for Simulix, which provides now a user-friendly solution to perform complex clinical trial simulations. I will come back on this on the next slide. In addition to this, we have a module to filter the data prior to analysis, a new library of tumor growth inhibition models, trend lines, the possibility to have trend lines displayed on plots of the observed data, so with the mean curve and standard deviations, more flexibility for non-compartmental analysis, in particular, the possibility to manage units in the data, to select parameters to compute and to stratify the results, a more flexible interface with a dark theme, the possibility to change the font size and so on, and also improved performances for data, libraries and algorithms, and many more. So let me come back on the new feature for Simulix. This is really the main new feature for this Monolix Suite 2020. Simulix now comes with a graphical user interface. Of course, it can also be used in R via an R API like the other applications of the Monolix Suite. But it has a user-friendly interface with an exploration and a simulation modules. So the exploration modules is a quite similar to what we had previously with ML Explore, but with a much more modern interface. It allows to simulate a typical individual and explore interactively the impact of the parameters on the model or different simple dosing regimens. And the simulation modules is more similar to what was possible to do for now with an R package. And now it will be possible in the interface to simulate whole new populations and whole clinical trials. Of course, this application is interconnected with Monolix, so it is possible to reuse elements that come from Monolix. And it is also possible to post-process the results of the simulation with outcomes and endpoints, replicate the simulation to assess the uncertainty of the results. And like the other applications, it contains built-in results and interactive plots in the interface. So now I'm going straight away to move on to the live demo. So I'm going to show you some of these new features. And for this, I will use as example a PK data set that compares two formulations for theophylline in a crossover study. So let me give you just very quickly a few words on this. It's a data set where the theophylline concentration has been measured in 18 healthy individuals. Each individual has received one of the two formulations 1 week apart with a randomized sequence. And the administration is oral and single dose. And I will begin by exploring this data in PKanalix and perform a non-compartmental analysis. Then I will quickly show how to perform population modeling on a subpart of this data in Monolix. And then I will use this model built in Monolix for further simulations in Simulix. Since the interface of Simulix is completely new, I will spend more time on this part to show really how to use it to simulate a clinical trial and investigate the results. So let me now open first PKanalix to load my dataset and explore it. So you can already notice that like all the applications of the Monolix suite, PKanalix has a bright new look in the interface with a more modern and colorful theme. And now I'm going to browse to find my dataset, which is on my desktop. The dataset is displayed here in the interface. So it contains a column ID, time in hour, period that correspond to the two different periods for the two different formulations that I will use as occasion. The amount is given in milligram in the column AMT. The two different formulations are distinguished with values 1 and 2 in the column ADM, used as administration ID. We have a column for the concentration, for a censoring column for censored observations, a limit column. Form is a categorical covariate that corresponds to the two different formulations, test and reference, test and ref, so I will use it as categorical covariate. And then we have three covariates, age, weight, and height, that are recognized as continuous covariates. And finally, sec corresponds to the sequence of formulations that was given to each individual. And here I can tag it as a stratification categorical covariate. This column type, stratification covariate, is a new type that we have introduced in this new version of the Monolix suite that allows you to have a covariate displayed in the plot and available in the plot for stratification. But this covariate won't be available for the covariate model in the interface, usually for covariates like this, where it is just the organization of the data and for which it would not be interesting to add them in the covariate model itself. So now I can accept. And now that my data has been accepted, you can see already some new features here on the top of this tab. We have a module for the units and a module to add additional covariates. In the additional covariates here, I can select covariates that will be added automatically by the software depending on the design of the data. It could be, for example, the first dose amount if the individuals had received different dose amounts. Or here in this case, it can be the administration type. So if I click on it, it will add a new stratification categorical covariate that will contain one for in the subject occasions who have received the first formulation and two for subject occasions who have received the second formulation. And here the software is not modifying really the data set itself, it's not modifying the file, but it's just adding on the fly new covariates that could be convenient for stratification of the plots. Now for the units, I can click here to enable the units module. And this allows me to select some units corresponding to the data, so to the time, concentration, and amount columns. So here, time is in hour, my concentration is in microgram per liter, and the amount is also in microgram. And now I can accept, and these units will now be used by the software to output also the units of the result of the PK parameters computed during NCA or CA, and also to display the units of concentration and time on the plot. So I can show you this right away by going to the tab plots here. Here, I'm going to focus today on the plot observed data, where I can see the concentration versus time. And here, if I click on units, I can display the units that I have entered in the units module in the tab data on the labels for the axis. You may have noticed also that we have a new feature on this plot, which is the black curve that corresponds to the mean, the curve of the mean and the standard deviation. It's not always easy to see in addition to the observed data, and this is why in display you can choose now to display all the data and the mean and standard deviation, or perhaps only the data as dots. And in that case, we can see more easily the trend lines, so the mean curves and the standard deviations. This standard deviation and the means are computed on bins. And here there is a tab to flexibly control how the bins are computed if necessary. Okay, so now I can stratify my data to try to compare the two formulations that were given. As before, you see that all the covariates from the data set are available for stratification here, and they are all automatically allocated to stratification groups, so they are all already ready to be used for stratification. So for categorical covariates, each category is assigned as a stratification group. And for continuous covariates, such as age, by default, two groups have been created with equal count. And of course, this can be modified. This can still be modified. So here I can directly click on form here to split my plot according to the two formulations. So I have the reference formulation on the left and the test formulation on the right. And you see that the trend lines allow me to very easily compare the two. You can notice also the covariate administration type here. So of course I can still combine the stratification with different covariates and I can color by administration type. This is the covariate that was added on the fly by the software and that is actually not in the initial, in the original data set. And here it corresponds actually to the two formulations. So it doesn't bring much more information in this case. Okay, so here I can see that there are some differences, very clear differences between the two formulations, probably with the absorption. And so now I'm going to perform a non-compartmental analysis on this data set to identify better the differences. So I will do tasks. And just before running the NCA, I'm going to save my project as a PKX file. Like this. In tasks here, you can notice a few new settings that are available as new features. Mainly, it is not now possible to define several partial AUC times. It was possible in the previous version to have to compute a single partial AUC, and now it is possible to combine to compute several. So I can define, for instance, select to have the AUC between 0 and 24 hours, and then between 24 hours and 48 hours. The second new feature that we can see here is this list here, which corresponds to the parameters to compute. So now, instead of having a big table of results after the non-compartmental analysis that contains all the possible parameters to compute, it is possible to select here to define a list of parameters to compute in order to have a smaller table with only the parameters that I am interested in. The default table here can be changed in the preferences. So if I open the preferences here, I can also show you some new features in the preferences. So the list that I have just shown is here. This list can be, the default list can be changed here and it will correspond to the default list displayed in the interface each time you open PKanalix. So it can be changed here. And then of course, it is possible in the interface to adjust this list for each analysis. So in addition to this new setting in preferences, we also have a few other new settings. In particular here, it is possible to change the font size for the numerical values and the number of significant digits that are displayed in the interface. Also here, I can change the font size for the text in the interface. And we now have a light and a dark theme that will change the interface like this. That allows you to really display the interface in a complete dark theme. In addition, also the plots are have also a dark theme colors. And this is more comfortable for some people, or some people maybe just like to have a geek look on their computer, so now you have the choice. So for myself, I will come back to the light theme here. Okay, so that's it for the new features on this tab. Now I also have to set some appropriate settings for my data set. So I will choose extravascular administration type for the two types of administration. I will choose linear up lockdown and missing BLQ method after Tmax, and I will choose an acceptance criteria based on the adjusted R-square value. As usually, before running the non-compartmental analysis, it is very convenient to check this tab, check lambda z, where I can check the regression, so the estimation of the lambda z for all individuals. And here there is a new convenient feature here with this information toggle that allows me to display on each plot the number of points that are used for each individual, and this number of points can vary when I choose, for example, the adjusted R-square main rule. For example, it will be high for this individual. And I can also see the value of the adjusted R-square. So this is really convenient to check which individual have a regression that is maybe less performant to check which one should be adjusted to try to get a better result. Okay, so now I can run the non-compartmental analysis. Oh, I just forgot to, I wanted to adjust a bit this list to remove some of the parameters so that we will have a smaller table. So I will do it now. I will remove all these parameters and I will keep only a few. Plus I will also have the parameters dedicated to the partial AUC that will be added to the results. So I will run it again. And now I have a list of results in the tab results here that contain only the parameters that I have selected in addition to the ID, the period, and the covariates, like usually. And you can see that in addition to this selection of parameters, I can see the unit corresponding to each parameter, which has been automatically computed based on the unit that I have set for the data. Now, this is for the table for the individual estimate. So I have all the parameters for all the individual. Now, in the summary table that is here, I also can see the units corresponding to each parameter. And a new feature is this stratification panel here that allows me to filter this data. So I can filter here by adjusted R-square. This will remove from the summary the individuals who do not meet the acceptance criteria based on the adjusted R-square. And you can see on this column here and miss that here one individual was rejected out of the all the 36 subject occasions. One was rejected because it didn't meet the adjusted R2 acceptance criteria. So now the summary does not take this individual into account. Now for the split option, it is possible to split this summary table by the categorical covariates in the data. So here I can split it by form. And now I have one summary line per parameter and for each of my formulations. So I have the reference formulation and the test formulation, and I can compare easily, for example, the median for AUC to infinity. And of course, it is also possible to see these differences in the plots. In the individual parameters versus covariates. So here I can have a look at this plot. I can go to display and select here a few parameters. Here the selection of the parameters in this list is now much easier. And I can select maybe the AUC to infinity, Cmax, and AUC between 0 and 24 hours. And then on the covariates, I will just select form and I will rotate the layout. And now I can easily compare my box plots. And I see that although AUC to infinity and between 0 and 24 hours are quite similar between the two formulations, the Cmax is quite different. And this confirms what we have seen in the observed data that shows some differences in the absorptions for the two formulations. So now for the, and this is actually because the test formulation shows a dual sequential absorption, you know, in contrast with the reference formulation. So for the rest of the demo, I will focus on this formulation, the test formulation, and I will now move on to monoleaks and show how I can filter the data to take into account only this formulation. So I can save and export my project to monoleaks. I will call it TO test, for instance, since I will focus on the test formulation. And now this opens monoleaks that you can see here with also it's a new look for the interface. And now I'm going to have a look right away at data. So if you remember when exporting a project from PeakAnalytics to monoleaks, you have everything that is already set up in your project ready to do some population modeling. But here, instead of reusing the data set as it is, as it was used in PeakAnalytics, I'm going to filter it to focus only on the individuals corresponding to the test formulation, so the one that have the test value in the column form. And I can do this with this new module for filters. This module is now available in monoleaks and also in PeakAnalytics. And it allows me to, starting from my initial data here, my initial data set, it allows me to create a child data set. So a new data set derived from my original data set with a filter. The filter is defined here. I can rename it to call it, for instance, TOSD test. And in order to select my data, I can choose one of these actions. So I can select whole IDs, or just select lines, or remove whole IDs, or just remove lines. In this case, I'm going to select some lines according to some criteria that I will define here. And I can define my criteria based on any column from my data set. And in my case, I'm going to use form, the categorical covariate, as base for my criteria. And I will choose the form values that are equal to test. And now I will accept this and apply. So this is a simple example of a filter where I just set one criteria and apply it. But it is also possible to combine different filters and to combine different criteria with intersections and unions of subsets of the data to create really complex filters of the data. So now the data considered by Monolix will correspond only to the individual, the subject or occasions who have received the test formulation. Note also that the filter does not actually modify the data set, but only how it is interpreted by Monolix. Now I can move on to the next tab, structural model. And here I will choose an appropriate model from the library, so a model that corresponds to a dual absorption. So I click on load from library. And here I will choose a model from this library, PK double absorption. But before doing this, let me do a small parenthesis to introduce this new library. This is a library of tumor growth inhibition model that is new in this version of Monolix. It is a quite large library that allows to choose with a lot of flexibility, a model with a growth component for the tumor growth, a treatment effect, and different types of dynamics for the treatment effect, and additional features such as resistance or delay or immune dynamics. So that's it for this small parenthesis. Now I will actually choose my model to model the double absorption in my PK data. So I'll choose the first absorption with a zero order and a lag time. A second absorption, which is a first order absorption with no delay, but a sequential order relatively to the first absorption, and then one compartment and a linear elimination. And here, the selection of the models in the libraries is more performant in this version and is much faster. So I can select this model now and use it to model my PK data. And this brings me to the tab initial estimates that you already know. And here I can choose some good initial values and then I can estimate my model. So instead of doing it right now, I will save some time to show you the simulations afterwards. So instead I will just load directly my final PK model to model this data in Monolix. I will show you the results and then I will move on straight to the simulations. So I will load this model here. So this is the same model that I have just selected in the PK library for double absorptions with the same parameters, some random effects. I have a two covariate effect of age and weight on two parameters. I have the results, which are fine. So I won't detail all the small new features that we have brought to Monolix. But I can mention mainly that we have improved the algorithm in the case of inter-occasion variability. And we have also introduced a more efficient statistical test to check whether a covariate effect should be removed from the model. So that would be this test here, which now gives more reliable results. Also, one other nice new feature is in the plots. So I will generate them to show you. So in the plot, well, I can see that in the individual fits, my model seems to capture quite well the data. And I can check this with the VPC, the visual predictive check. And a new feature for the VPC is that it is now possible to export the simulations generated for the VPC with this button here, export and export VPC simulations. And when I click here, it will export the simulations as a table that is saved in the result folder of the project. Okay, so you see that this model captures quite well the data. And now I will use this model estimated in Monolix on single dose data to simulate multiple doses with the test formulation. So to this end, I will now open Simulix. And here we have the brand new interface of Simulix. So this is really the big new feature of this new Monolix suite, and we are really excited to present it. So when you open Simulix, you can either start a new simulation from scratch with new project. In that case, I need to load a model and specify the parameter values for the simulation and the dosing regimen also for the simulations. Or I can import a Monolix project. And in this case, I can reuse elements from the Monolix project, such as the model or the parameter values, without having to redefine them. So this is what I will do now. I will import the model that I have just shown you in Monolix, so the final Monolix run for this PK data. And I will increase the size of the interface. And now we can see the different tabs of the Simulix interface. So Simulix is organized in three tabs: definition, exploration, and simulation. In definition, the first tab, this is where all the elements needed for simulating the model, such as parameters or treatments, are defined and can be modified. And the next tabs, exploration and simulation, that I will show afterwards, are where these elements can be selected to simulate the model. So after importing the project from Monolix, many elements are already automatically copied from the Monolix project. So in model, you can see already that the model used in the Monolix project has been copied here. It contains the description of the covariates in the block covariates, the models for the individual parameters here in the block individual. And here in the block longitudinal, you can see the model, the structural model. This is the model that I have selected from the library of PK models with double absorption. And this model, the output of this model is a CC. This is the output that I will use for the simulation. This corresponds to the prediction of the plasma concentration without residual error. Okay. Then some other elements have been automatically define when importing the Monolix run. In occasions, first, since the initial Monolix project is based on a crossover study with occasions, then the occasions for each ID is already specified. And this is useful if I want to resimulate the same design as in Monolix. But if I want to simulate a new design, I can also delete it and create a new different design. As another example, in population parameters, an element MLX pop has been generated. This is a vector of values that I can view with this button. And it contains the population estimate for Monolix. So using this, I can, using this in the simulation, Simulix will draw new individual parameters from the population distribution. And of course, I can modify it or create another vector of population parameters to use different distributions for the parameters for the simulation. For some of the simulation elements, for example, covariates, Simulix generates several options from the initial Monolix project that I can choose from the simulation. And so here, for instance, I have the choice between MLX-COV, which is a table of individual covariate values that I can view here. So these are the individual covariate values from the initial data set. And I can also choose MLX-COV-DIST, which are distribution laws. So if I click here and to view this distribution, they are derived from the values in the initial data set, but they could allow me to draw new values for age and weight for my simulation with a similar distribution than in the initial data set. So I won't show all the elements in detail, but you can see that when I come from Monolix, I already have all the elements I need to simulate the model. And when I go to simulation, this part here is the part when I can run the simulation and some post-processing on the simulation. And this part here is the list of elements that will be used for the simulation. And you can see that some elements are already selected by default, such that everything is ready to resimulate the same project as in Monolix, with the same group size as in the initial data, new parameters that will be drawn from the population distributions estimated in Monolix, a table of doses and a table of covariate values that come from the initial data, and as output, the concentration with residual error, with the same measurement times as in the initial data. And we have seen that there are actually several options for some of the elements. So I can modify the default choice to select something else if I want. For example, I can decide not to use the same covariate values, the exact same covariate values as in the initial data that are used saved in MLEScove, but I can draw new covariate values from the distributions defined in MLEScove-dist. And in addition to selecting other already generated elements, of course, I can define new elements from scratch to simulate new situations that do not come from the monolith project. And this is what I will do now in order to simulate multiple doses instead of the original single doses. So to do this, I go back to definition. And I will begin by deleting the structure of occasions here because I do not want to consider several occasions per individual. So actually, I do not need this element. And now I go to treatment to define a new treatment. The original treatment generated from monolith has been removed because it was only compatible with the previous structure of occasions. But instead, I can define a new element for multiple doses. And when defining a new element, I can define a manual element by entering manually each dosing time and each dose amount that will be applied to all individuals. I can define an external element by loading a table that would contain each individual dose, or I can define a regular element where I can set a vector of dosing times that will be applied with the same amount to all individuals. And so I begin by defining here a vector of 7 doses that will be given each day, so every 24 hours. And I will start with an amount of 1,000 milligrams that I will use as reference dosing regimen. And I will call this dosing regimen 1,000 milligram once daily. Then I need to define an output for the simulation. That will have longer measurement times than in the original data. So I create a new output that I call CC 1 week. So I will record CC during 1 week. So I will base this on the variable CC. I will record CC every hour, and I will do it until 168 hours, so during 1 week. And now I can use these two new elements in exploration to explore my new treatment. In exploration, the left panel here is the list of elements used for the simulation. By default, the exploration simulates a typical individual using the typical population parameters estimated by monolith and saved in MLEXpopInDiv. And now I can choose my new treatment, and the output has been chosen already. So I can apply, and I get in the middle, I see the prediction based on these elements. And on the right, I can change the values for the parameters and for the treatment here. I can change the values for the interdose interval, for example, or the number of doses. And I can see in real time how it affects the prediction. So this tab really allows me to explore iteratively the model and the impact of the parameters and the treatment. For theophylline, the standard therapeutic range usually considered is between 5 and 15 milligrams per liter. So if I come back to my initial treatment of 7 doses every day, I can see that the steady state concentration with 100 milligrams once daily for the typical individual comes is a bit higher than 15 milligrams per liter at Cmax. So this treatment will induce toxicity in patients. Now I will add a reference to keep this prediction on the plot, and I can now change the amount to check how decreasing the amount will impact the toxicity. So if I choose 900, for example, it seems that the dose amount of 900 milligram could avoid toxicity, at least for a typical individual, and it should not affect too much the efficacy. So as a first step, I will just focus on toxicity, and I will investigate what is the real impact of decreasing the amount to 900 milligrams when I simulate it on a whole new population, which I can do in the tab simulations. So in order to do this, I do not need to create from scratch a new treatment element for the 900 milligrams, but I can create it from here directly. So this will record, this will save in a new element the values that I have modified in the interactive exploration tab. So I can just give it a new name, 900 milligram once daily. And now in simulation, I can click here to create two groups of simulations to compare the treatment with multiple doses with the reference dose of 1000 milligrams, sorry, and with a new amount of 900 milligrams. By default, all elements here are shared across the two groups, and I can click here to have a group-specific treatment and select the first treatment for the first group and the second treatment for the second group. For the outputs, I will choose CC 1 week, and I can rename the groups here to have some more meaningful names. So I will call my first treatment arm 1000 milligram and the second 900 milligram. So now I can run the simulation with these two groups. Oh, sorry, I forgot to change the number of individuals. The group size is still at 18, which was the initial group size. Actually, it would be more meaningful to have a larger group size to really check the variability in the simulation. So I will choose 200 as a group size. And now I will run again the simulation. And the result of the simulation can then be seen in a tab results, as tables, and also in the plots. So in table, I see, for instance, the table of the individual parameters and covariates that have been drawn from the distributions for each individual of the two groups. And then I will show the rest of the results in the plot. So in the plot, I can see the individual curves corresponding to the output. So for CC versus time, this is an interactive plot. So I can see each individual curve corresponding to each new simulated ID. You see that I have also the trend lines that are displayed on this plot. And I can maybe change the number of beans to have a smaller number of beans to have something more rough trend line. So here it's a bit crowded because I have 200 individuals, so it's a lot. So it would be easier to compare the two groups here in output distribution. And on this plot, the same results are displayed as distribution, so with the median simulation as the black curve here, and then bands that correspond to the percentiles. And here I can see already that, of course, with 900 milligrams, the concentration at steady state is a bit lower. And what is convenient in this case to check the impact on the toxicity is to add visual cues. So here I can add horizontal lines or vertical lines or dots as visual cues on the plot. And I will add with a freehand guide a horizontal line at about 15 milligram per liter, which is the toxicity threshold. And I can do it with a freehand guide like this, or I can also just enter the correct value 15. And here I can see that, so for the first treatment arm, 1000 milligram each day, the median simulation reaches the toxicity threshold. And for the second treatment arm, the median simulation is quite below the toxicity threshold, but there is still a significant portion of the simulations for which the Cmax is above the toxicity threshold. So this is what I see on the plot, but now I would like to actually count the percentage of individuals that are above this threshold in each case in order to compare the two groups in a more quantitative way. And this is something that can be done in simulation. In the panel outcomes and endpoints, I can define here outcomes, so quantitative results of a simulation with one outcome value per ID and an endpoint, which is a summary of all the outcome values over each simulation group. To create a new outcome, I click here, and in my case, I would like to count the number of individuals in each group which has a Cmax above 15. So this output will be based on CC, my output CC 1 week. And then I can take the maximum value for, from this output. I could take the value, the maximum value or the time of the maximum value. I will take the maximum value. And I am actually not interested in the exact value, but just on the fact that it could be higher or smaller than the toxicity threshold. So I will apply a threshold and I will count the number of individuals that actually do not reach the toxicity target, so for which the Cmax stay below 15. And I will call this Cmax below 15. I click OK, and this new outcome is now displayed here, and it is automatically associated with an endpoint that will summarize this outcome in each group. Here, because the value of the outcome will be a true or false value, depending of, on if each ID reaches or not the toxicity target, then the summary endpoint is the percentage of individuals for which it will be true. I can change the name of this endpoint and I can call it toxicity, for instance. And of course, it is possible to define several outcomes and several endpoints, but here I will just keep this single one to have something simpler. So now I can select this tab, this task outcome and endpoints. I could run it together with the simulations with this button here. But here, actually, I do not need to change the simulations that have been performed. I just need to post-process the result to compute the outcome and the endpoint. And so I can just run this task alone without having to rerun the simulation. I get the results in the results hold. So now, in addition to the simulation tab, I also have a tab with endpoints and group comparison. And in endpoints, I can see, for instance, in the table of outcome, the value of the outcome for each ID in each simulation group. So for example, the first ID has a Cmax that stays below 15. And then, of course, I can see a summary of these outcomes. And I have more or less the same information here in the table of endpoints, because the endpoint summarizes the outcome values in each group. So here I have a summary with the percentage of individuals for which this outcome stays true. So the individuals that complies with the toxicity criteria, that do not reach the toxicity. And I can compare it over the two, across the two groups. So I see that indeed decreasing the amount from 1000 to 900 milligrams increases the number of individuals, the percentage of individuals that stay safe of toxicity. And the same result can be seen in the plots here with the distribution of the outcome, which is a bit easier to see here as stacked bar plots. So I have the number of individuals for which it is false and for which it is true. And actually, the results are not so very different between the two groups. So we can wonder whether this difference is significant or not. And another question is, if I redo the same simulation, so I will draw again new individual parameters and covariates, will I then get the same result with similar, with quite similar endpoints between the two groups, or did this result occur just by chance the first time? So in other words, is this result really representative of what I might get in reality, and what variability can I expect? So I can answer these questions by doing replicates of this simulation and assess the results over the replicates. To do this, I come back to simulation and I select multiple replicates here. So to have a reasonable computing time for the demo, I will choose 20 replicates and I will decrease the group size, the number of individuals in each simulation group to 100. And moreover, here in the part for outcomes and endpoints, I will select decision criteria. This will compare the endpoint toxicity between the two arms with the first arm as reference. And I can choose either a direct comparison to check that the odd ratio of endpoints is different from one, or a statistical test that will compute the certainty that the odd ratio between the two groups is different from one with a p-value. And I can set a threshold here for the p-value to accept or reject the decision that the two groups are different. So here I will consider that the differences in toxicity are significant if the p-value is smaller than 0.05. So now I can run again the two tasks with replicates. Okay, and now that the results are updated, let me show you the result first on the plot. So here I now have again an additional plot that shows the distributions of my endpoints, so toxicity in each group, as a percentage in the target and as quantity in target. So it's more or less the same information. And here I can see that the percentage of individuals who meet the toxicity criteria, so who are not affected by toxicity based on my toxicity threshold, is the median percentage is around 40% in my first treatment arm and around 55% in my second arm. But this percentage actually varies quite a lot from one simulation to the other. So although the median percentage is quite different, the difference might not always be significant for each new simulation. And in the result, I can check this in the section group comparison. Now this section gives me for each, so for my endpoint toxicity, the odd ratio between the second arm and the first arm, which is the reference. And in addition to the odd ratio, I see the p-value that for the test that checks whether the odd ratio is different from one. When the p-value is smaller than 0.5, then the success of the comparison is indicated in this column. So we can see that for all the simulations with a green check, the difference between the two arms is indeed significant, otherwise it is not. And finally, there is a summary table that gives me the percentage of success over replicates. So here I see that I have a 55% of improving the toxicity endpoint by decreasing the dose amount from 1000 milligram to 900. So this should lead me to investigate this further as this is a promising new treatment. So as a summary for Simulix, you have seen that Simulix now provides a really user-friendly solution to quickly perform both simple and complex simulations. You can simulate in exploration a typical individual and explore interactively the impact of the parameters on the treatment. Or you can simulate whole new populations of individuals with new elements in simulations. And simulation groups, such as clinical trials, can be easily compared in the tables and in the plots. And it is also possible to define outcomes and endpoints, like in a real clinical trial, and assess the uncertainty of the endpoints and the power of the study. Of course, this was just a first simple example. There are many more possibilities to Simulix, and we are very excited for everyone to discover them, and this will be possible very soon. So with that, I will just show again, let me display this reminder of the main new features of Monolix Suite here. And now we will take questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Pauline, for your presentation. So I'm going to go again over the questions that you have asked in the Q&A box so that we can also answer them orally. So first, as a reminder, so the 2020 release is not yet out. It will be released in October, rather end of October. And the webinar is recorded and will be publicly available tomorrow or the day after. So first, a question, a bit a general question about the compatibility between the previous version and this one. If I have done a run in Picanalix or Monolix in 2019 version, can I reload it in the 2020 version?
Yes, we ensure that we support retrocompatibility, so it is possible to load all projects with the new version.
Okay, great. Regarding the part really on the data, so the filters and the additional covariates, are these kind of choices saved into the .mlxtrand file, or are they saved as a new data set? I mean, do I have a way to see the new data set or the new covariate values somewhere?
So it is saved in the MLExtran or the PKX file, not as a new data set. However, you can see the new interpreted data set in the tab data in the interface. This is really the new data that will be used for the analysis that is displayed in the interface.
Okay, thanks. A few questions about peak analytics. So about bioequivalence, is there a plan to add in the future a module to do bioequivalence analysis? So for example, to calculate the ratio of the test and the ref formulation?
Yes, so this is something that we would really like to do probably for the next version. It was not possible for this one because we cannot do everything at the same time, but probably for the next version, we will try to do it.
Great. And what about doing reports? So if I want to kind of run the NTA analysis on several data sets and output all my tables and plot to a Word report, for instance, is that something that we plan?
So we can, it's not planned exactly in the interface. We can provide an R script that can perform this.
Yeah, so the plan is to release our package that would run in the background peak analytics using the R API and then allow you to like format the result as tables and plots with some defaults that are already included, and then combine this to another R package that allows you to generate a Word report. So the idea would be that you would have create yourself your Word template, provide your Word template with a kind of keywords in it that would then be replaced by the tables and plots generated after running peak analytics. So this is something we're working on. It will probably be beginning of next year, so beginning of 2021. All right, so that was about peak analytics. Now going on to monolithics. There is no units in monolix, right?
No, the units are only in peak analytics.
Okay. Now we have quite a lot of questions about Simulix because that's our new great application. So first question, is it possible to overlay external data on top of the plots?
No, unfortunately, this is not possible yet.
But it's planned for the 2021 release. How do you ensure the reproducibility of the results? So what is saved exactly and what is output also?
For the reproducibility, so the simulations are based on the random seed that is set in the project settings and can be changed. So you always get the same results when you run the same project. And then all the results are saved in the result folder next to the Simulix project, like for Monolix, where we save the estimation results in the result folder next to the Monolix file. And the result will appear in the interface of Simulix only if they are really compatible, they are consistent with all the elements in the interface. So if the same elements were defined to run the simulation.
Okay, thanks. And in the presentation, we could see this small box, same individuals among groups in Simulix. What is it? When is it useful? What is it doing exactly?
Yeah, so indeed, I did not take the time to present the small features that are here that are some settings that can be used to change the way the simulations are done. So this setting here can be used to compare really the same individual values in two groups. So for example, here I am drawing some individual parameters from population distribution. Without checking this box, by default, new individual parameters are drawn for each of the two groups. There are different individual parameters. But if you want to really compare the same individuals in the two groups, but with different treatments, then checking this box will ensure that you will have the same individual parameters used in the first group and in the second.
Okay, great, thanks. For the moment, you have used the population parameters estimated by Monolix. Would it be possible to take the uncertainty of these population parameter values into account?
No, unfortunately, this is not possible. Not possible yet.
In this release, it's something we plan for the next one, and that's, however, something that we have added in the R version of Simulix. There, we will have a function to sample sets of population parameters from the uncertainty distribution that can then be passed as a data frame to the simulation, such that, for instance, each replicate is using a different set of population parameters. So yes, in the R package, no, not yet for the graphical user interface.
But as a population, the tables of population parameters that can be generated from the uncertainty distributions in R can then also be used in the interface. So you can also just do this part in R, and then the rest you can still do it in the interface.
Okay, so now related to covariates, would it be possible to have my covariate values in a text data file outside of Simulix and take this as an input to sample from this data set?
Yes, of course. So this is possible in definition for all the elements, and in particular for covariates. This corresponds to the type external, what we call external. So here you can just load a table that should contain, it can be a table of covariate values. And then Simulix will sample from this table to perform the simulation.
Okay, thanks. And if I want to define the covariate as a distribution, what kind of distributions are available? Can we modify it?
Sure, so I can show it now. So if I want to define a new distribution for age, for instance, I have the choice between normal, log normal, logit normal, and uniform. And for each type, I can set the limits for the uniform interval, for instance, or the typical and standard deviation for the other distributions. And also here I have only continuous covariates, but if you have categorical covariates, you can also define probability distributions for the categorical covariates, so the probability of having each category.
Okay, thanks. We again have several questions about the output of Simulix. So would it be possible to output the simulated values in Excel, for instance?
So we do have the simulated values saved in a table, as a table in the result folder. So it is so here I did not save my project, which is a bad practice. So it will be difficult for me to show you the results. They will be all mixed in my temporary folder, but of course this table is available in the result folder and you can open it in Excel.
And going back to the covariates, so when we define covariates via distribution, is it possible to define the correlation between these distributions?
No, this is not possible.
So again, the workaround would be to generate your values outside of Simulix and then import an external data file with your covariate values that can have some correlation. Thank you very much for attending.
Okay, thank you everyone. Bye.
Thank you, bye-bye.